Thank you. So good morning, everybody. So I, first of all, I must thank the organizers for including me in this great meeting. I must also thank ICTS for the great hospitality. Honestly speaking, I was a bit surprised when I received the invitation to this meeting, because I come from a chemistry background and I deal at the molecular scales, which is way beyond most of the talks that we have been hearing so far. But I'm glad that I accepted this invitation. At least I got to learn so many different ideas and topics that has been discussed so far. And I hope that although we are going to dig deep into the molecular level, I hope that I'll at least try to give you some ideas that how understanding things, this disease-related problems at the molecular scale can give us really useful insights. And since I realize that it's a diverse audience, so I'll spend more time on discussing the ideas or the challenges behind the techniques that we normally use, rather than talking about a specific problem or results. And I encourage you to interrupt me and stop me at any point. I don't need to really finish my talk, but I'd rather have you all with me throughout. So as the title suggests, so I'm going to primarily talk about this class of techniques called enhanced sampling techniques, which is beyond the regular molecular dynamics simulations probably many of you have heard of. So I'm going to touch upon that, and I'm going to show that how computing the free energy landscape can provide us a really useful and quantitative yardstick when we are looking into these complex biomolecular or biophysical processes. Okay, and this misfolding and aggregation in prion proteins will be just a test case to show you some of the ideas. Okay, so what we are really looking for? So we would like to understand really proteins, right? Proteins are essentially the molecular workhorses in our body. And so essentially, if we have a structure of a protein molecule, we'd like to understand the function of the molecule. How does that molecule work at the molecular scale? What are the interactions? And essentially, how it functions? And in case of disease-related proteins, how do they dysfunction, right? And the approach that we'd like to take is we'd like to understand the dynamics, the motion of these molecules. These molecules are not static structures. They move, really move. They change their shape and so on, and those are really crucial for their function. And the thermodynamics, and I'm going to talk more about these aspects. And the approach that we take to do this structure-function connection is going through the energetics, essentially, the interactions. And the field that helps us in doing this connection is statistical mechanics. So essentially, that's where we connect the interactions at the molecular scale to the macroscopic properties and thermodynamic variables that I'm going to talk about. So essentially, I'm going to talk about a term, molecular thermodynamics, quite a bit. So what is this molecular thermodynamics? Is it an oxymoron? If you remember a bit of thermodynamics from your basic chemistry or physics in your undergraduates, you would probably remember that thermodynamics is a subject of macroscopic objects. When you talk about temperature, pressure, enthalpy, entropy, all these thermodynamic terms, you don't really need to talk in terms of molecules, right? But here, what I'm going to really convince you that even at the molecular scale, if you think in terms of these thermodynamic variables, we can really understand a lot of the functional, the function of the biochemical and biophysical processes. So for example, let's take this toy problem that if you put a kind of a polymer, which can be a protein molecule, it can have this extended chain. If you put it in water, in most of the cases, it will fold into a nice structure, which is the native structure of the folded protein. Now the question is, how does it fold? Whether it will really fold, which way this equilibrium will shift? Whether it is more stable in this folded state or it's more stable in the unfolded state? Or what kind of structure this is going to adopt? So in order to understand this, basic physical chemistry tells us that everything in nature under ambient conditions will be driven by free energy. So assuming that you remember a little bit of free energy, it's essentially a function of both, it's a competition between the energy and the entropy. And if we start thinking about this simple thermodynamic problem, so let's say you have this two-state problem, unfolded and the folded states, and this is the change in the free energy, which is essentially related to the change in the energy and the entropy. It's a kind of a schematic, simplistic picture. But if we start decomposing all these terms, for example, this delta E, the change in the energy in going from unfolded to folded state, we can see that there are different kinds of interactions. For example, the torsional interactions or the non-bonded interactions. Different kinds of interactions would favor, some of them will favor the folded state, and some of them will favor the unfolded state. All the red terms here favors the folded state, and all the green terms here favor the folded state. And similarly, there are all these competitions or the cancellations between various energy terms, as well as in the entropy terms. So essentially what I'm trying to tell here, that in biology or in biochemistry, essentially we are dealing with this cancellation and competition between various kinds of thermodynamic parameters. There can be different kinds of interactions, there can be different kinds of entropy, and essentially if we can compute all these terms, we can find out which will win and which state will be more stable and why. So we get the mechanistic picture of any chemical or biochemical equilibrium, or where there are multiple species at equilibrium, we can figure out the reason behind the relative stability of one species over another. So that's the idea, that we are going to compute the free energy. And in reality, so this is something we are going to actually compute. This is something called a free energy surface. I'm going to come to the mathematics of it, but I just want to convince you at this point that essentially, let's say I have these two species, A and B. Say in this case, I'm basically my x coordinate is something it's called radius of gyration, which is a measure of the shape of the molecule. So essentially, if you have a large radius of gyration, this is the unfolded state of the molecule, and this is the folded state. But the point is that if you know the free energy as a function of one such variable, which I'll call reaction coordinate, and if that reaction coordinate can distinguish between the species, essentially, this is what is called a free energy surface, where we can clearly get the free energy of the species A and the species B. And if you can get the free energy difference, essentially what we have is the population ratio. So the population ratio of multiple species or the equilibrium constant is related to the free energy difference between the two species. So that's my point one. And if you can compute the free energy barrier in going from the state A to state B, there is something called a transition state here. If there is a barrier, it takes a while for the system to cross the barrier, and the rate of crossing the barrier is again related to the free energy barrier of this surface. So the point is, if you can compute the free energy surface of a biochemical or biophysical process, one, you have the population ratio of all the species. You know that which species will be more stable over another. And also you know that if you can compute the free energy barrier, essentially you know the rate constants of these transitions. So that's what we are going to do, to compute the free energy surface. Now, what's the theory behind it? So just before actually going into the calculation, let me just give you the motivation, why we are trying to do this. So this is a very famous picture of protein folding energy landscape. So essentially, I guess many of you would be familiar with this picture, that protein folds on a funnel-like energy landscape, right? So this is, you can imagine that this is the y-axis is the energy scale, and on here, you have all this configurational space. So when you are at the high energy state, you have this unfolded state, so you have this huge amount of protein conformations, but as you come lower and lower, the number of configurations is going down, so the entropy is going down, essentially, and in this deep minimum, you have the native state or the folded state of the protein. And, of course, as you can see, there are many local intermediate metastable states, like these are the folding intermediates, and these are the partially folded states, and so on. So this is when you have only one protein molecule. But again, this is the intramolecular contact. This is my reaction coordinate in some sense. But if you now start to include multiple proteins in the system, so for example, these unfolded states, multiple of these states can start to aggregate. Now we have this intermolecular contact coordinate space where we can have this kind of amorphous aggregates and this kind of oligomers. And finally, we can also have this deep minima corresponding to the amyloid fibrils, which are essentially responsible for these neurodegenerative diseases caused by protein misfolding and aggregation. So the point is here that if we can somehow get this full free energy landscape of a protein, both in the intramolecular and the intermolecular coordinate space, essentially we know everything about the all possible conformational states and the aggregation state. And what is interesting about this schematic picture is apparently tells that this amyloid fibril state is apparently even more stable than the native state. So if you somehow allow the protein to actually go into this direction, it will irreversibly go into this amyloid fibril aggregated state, and it will basically, it will not be able to come back. So that's the motivation. So this is the problem that we are going to look into. So essentially, we are going to compute such free energy landscapes of protein folding and misfolding. But before that, let me briefly tell you how we do this. Okay, so molecular dynamic simulation is nothing but solving Newton's equation of motion. Essentially, if you know the potential energy surface of the system, so this is here is the energy or the potential energy of the system as a function of all the degrees of freedom. So if you have, let's say, n particles, each particle will have, say, x, y, z, three degrees of freedom. Essentially, you have 3n dimensional function. So which is the potential energy surface, this energy of the total system described by its internal degrees of freedom. Now, if you basically, the derivative of that, the gradient, gives you the force. So if you know the potential energy surface of the underlying system, you know the force acting on each particle. And if you know the force, you know the acceleration, and you can numerically integrate acceleration to get the velocity, and you can integrate velocity to get the position. So simply, this is the idea that one, if you know the underlying potential energy surface, if you know the initial position and velocity of a system of particles, you can propagate this trajectory by doing this simple numerical integration. It's essentially, you know how the in real time how the system evolves with time. So that's all very simple. Now the question is, do we know this potential energy surface accurately? How do we model this? Now, for a chemical system, for a relatively small chemical system, it's as simple as solving Schrodinger equation, okay? So for a real, relatively small chemical system, we can actually solve Schrodinger equation, we can get the energies and forces accurately, and you can run molecular dynamics simulation on that surface, what is also called an ab initio molecular dynamics, where so essentially you don't have any adjustable parameters in your model, you derive all the forces and energies from quantum chemistry, which is theoretically exact, and you can exactly mimic the dynamics and the interactions of the system. But in reality, quantum mechanical methods are extremely slow. So what we take and weigh out, and we assume that even at the molecular scale, in some cases which is acceptable to do, that we assume that classical mechanics works, and the model kind of, the model we use is also called molecular mechanics. So molecular mechanics is nothing but where we assume that the total potential energy surface that we talked about can be broken into this individual pairwise additive terms. For example, you can consider this is a molecule where it is consisting of balls and springs where they're just basically oscillating. So these bonds are stretching, for example, this bond is stretching, this angle is stretching, and there is this torsional motion. So if you can dissect all possible molecular motions in terms of the internal degrees of freedom, we can start to model each of such interactions using some empirical functions. For example, for a collection of molecules, the total energy can be dissected by bonded and the non-bonded interactions, and the bonded interaction can be broken into bond, angle, and torsion, and non-bonded interactions are essentially van der Waals interactions and the electrostatic interactions. Electrostatic interactions are simply Coulomb's, you can describe by simple Coulomb's law. So that's your model. So essentially, each of these terms, you have to describe by a set of empirical functions. For example, a bond you can approximate by a harmonic spring, which is nothing but a harmonic oscillator model. An angle oscillation also you can model by a spring. Torsional potential is a cosine function, it's a periodic function. This is a model for the van der Waals interaction, and the electrostatic interactions is modeled by all these partial charges. So essentially, this is our model that for one class of molecules, if we formulate this set of functions and the parameters associated with them, they constitute what is called a force field. Okay, and in the context of biomolecules, proteins, DNA, and so on, we have really well established set of force fields, which are nothing but a set of these equations and their parameters, which describe the interaction of this collection of particles for any values of for any structure. You give the coordinate. You get the forces and the energies, and you solve Newton's equation of motion to get the dynamics. It's as simple as that. So that's where this is what is our model within molecular mechanics. So essentially, if we run the molecular dynamics simulations, if we run it long enough, the system will automatically should visit all the states that is accessible to that protein. So essentially, if you run it long enough, the protein should visit the folded state, unfolded state, the intermediate state, and so on and so forth. And one of the major success stories of this kind of modeling approach has been, it has been really shown that if you start with a fully extended chain of a protein, and you just run blind molecular dynamics simulation, using huge supercomputers, this molecular dynamics simulations have shown that it can actually fold to the native structure, which exactly matches with the crystal structure. So we are now at a stage where this kind of force field and molecular mechanics models can reliably reproduce the structure of the folded proteins. So essentially, now if we run these molecular dynamics simulations, so we can reproduce the distribution, the probability distribution of these states, these individual conformational states, and it should follow this kind of Boltzmann distribution. And any average observable can be computed by, essentially, if you know the probability distribution, any average observable can be computed. And to compute free energy, statistical mechanics tells us that if you get the partition function, which is this, essentially this integral, so it's a kind of a normalization constant of this probability distribution, and you get the free energy. So free energy is nothing but the minus log of the partition function. And so this gives us the total free energy. That's a mathematical framework of how you, from the interaction potentials, how you go to the free energy. Now, so this gives, so we can use these techniques like molecular dynamics and Monte Carlo to get the probability distribution. Now, in addition to the total absolute free energy, which is actually one number for the whole system, in practice, what we do is we actually compute free energy surface, because more often than not, we are more interested in free energy along a limited subset of configurations. So we are not interested in this full integral over all the 3n degrees of freedom. Essentially, what we do, we choose a few limited set of coordinates, or the reaction coordinates, and then we evaluate this integral over that one, this limited set of reaction coordinates, and what we get at the end is free energy as a function of those limited set of coordinates. So essentially, in a pictorial diagram, you can get this free energy surface, which is a function of this limited set of reaction coordinates, where you have integrated out all other degrees of freedom. So essentially, you have a kind of a projection on a limited set of reduced degrees of freedom, which will essentially distinguish between all your intermediate states that you are interested in. So this is a pictorial description of a free energy surface, where you can see that this deep minima, these blue regions, they essentially signify the stable states. So for example, this particular protein can exist in these multiple conformational states. And as you can see, it's not a simple two-state picture. There can be multiple intermediate conformational states, and you can actually compute the free energy barrier of going from one state to another. So that's the whole overall idea, that essentially, if you run a long molecular dynamics simulation and you calculate the probability distribution of visiting all these intermediate conformational state, if you take the log of minus log of that, that's going to give you the free energy surface. So this is theoretically exact. But in reality, what happens is, in reality, this barrier, if this barrier is large, what we call is activation energy barrier. So normally, if you have, say, for example, you have two states, A and B, separated by a large energy barrier, and most of the time the system is spending here in state A, which is accessible by the thermal energy, right? So it will take a long time. The probability of crossing this barrier will be related to, as I said, it will be related to this barrier, right? So higher the barrier, it will take to cross this barrier. So there will be some trajectories which will cross this, but we'll have to wait for a long time, right? So essentially, what we are talking about is rare events. So if we have a complex energy landscape, or a free energy landscape, where we have multiple states separated by a large barrier, so essentially, we have a problem in simple brute force molecular dynamics. So we'll have to use some other techniques. So that's where enhanced sampling techniques comes into the picture. So what are those? So just to give you an idea that how rare is this rare. So this expression of rate constants comes from, Right, yeah. So normally it will be better if you have already the crystal structure of the protein. So we need to, so depends on your problem, right? So if you want to actually study the folding process itself, you should start from any extended chain configuration of the protein. It doesn't matter where you start from. But let's say I want to study what happened, the dynamics of the protein near the minima of the native state, right? So then I should start near the minima. So normally I would prefer to take the crystal structure which is normally available for most of the proteins that we study. Let's say the structure is not available, there are some computational techniques like homology modeling where you can even try to model the protein structures. So it's, if you want to study the folded structure of the protein or the native state, you should start from that crystal structure.
So yeah.
Theoretically speaking, if your force field is accurate, anywhere you start from, if you run a long enough simulation, everything should be sampled according to their energy distribution. But most of the time, we are limited by our computer time. So if you are closer to the minima, you will get your correct distribution faster. So obviously, it's much more recommended that you start, you should start from the region where you want to sample. Let's say you want to sample this state, A. So you should prepare your system somewhere close to this minima. But let's say you want to study actually this unfolded state or B. So if you start from here, if you wait long enough, eventually it should go to B, but it will take a very long time. So you should rather prepare your system here somehow, but you should then have some idea what that state B is. And many times you don't have that idea. So these are the challenging aspects. But let's say if you know that you want to actually study the normal dynamics of the folded state of the protein, that's a more practical approach would be to start from the crystal structure. Yeah. Okay, so just to give you an idea that about these timescales of these barrier crossings, so this is the barrier values in kcal per mole unit. So if you are in the regime of 5 to 10 kcal, the timescales are in the regimes of nanoseconds to microseconds. When you go to 20 kcal, it goes to 1 minute, 25 kcal, 3 days, 30 kcal becomes 40 years. So even for some processes where the barrier is of the order of 30 kcal, this is rare even at the experimental timescales. And there are problems like homogeneous nucleation, ice nucleation, and so on that belong to this class of rare events. Now, coming back to even molecular dynamics, so even with a decent supercomputing cluster for maybe 100 thousands of atoms, particles, we can barely go to maybe tens of milliseconds to some people can go to hundreds of milliseconds and so on. All right. So if we have a system of the order of maybe 20 kcal barrier, there is no way we can actually see such barrier crossing event even in a year's time. So that's not practical, right? So that's when we have to use some mathematical tricks or to basically speed up this process of barrier crossing. That's what we are going to do. So the first class of techniques that we basically was developed in the early 70s is called umbrella sampling. So let's say you have a large barrier separating these two stable minima. What we can do, we can add a bias potential, an extra perturbation to the original Hamiltonian, which is an attractive harmonic potential around the barrier top. So essentially, if you have this original Hamiltonian, that's interaction potential, on top of it, you add additional bias term, which will essentially make this will be the effective potential now, it will make the barrier flat. So you basically force the system to visit, so basically you add an interaction energy term to reduce the energy value here, and then your system will be forced to sample that region of the coordinate space. So obviously now you have modified your underlying probability distribution and you should correct back for it. So there is a mathematical formalism. I'll not go into the details, but if you add an harmonic bias potential, for example, this is a normally accepted form of the bias potential. It can be an harmonic at, say, for example, at the position of x0. Now, this will be, so for example, here, whatever average you calculate, this average is computed over the bias potential, which is u plus w, and using this mathematical trick, you can recover the expectation value or the average property for the original unperturbed bias potential. So this is mathematically exact, this result, that you are adding a bias potential to force the system to sample at different regions. For example, originally the system will be sampling here, so the probability distribution will be something like this. But if you add a bias potential here, so now you have an effective potential something like this, and your probability distribution will be something like this. But then from here, you should go back to your unbiased original probability distribution, and there are neat mathematical tricks to do that, okay? So that's how we can selectively sample different regions of the phase space and get the free energy in that different regions. So that's one class of technique. Another class of technique, which is more recent and much more popular, is called metadynamics. Where here, what you do is you add a bias potential, but now it's a repulsive bias in contrast to the attractive bias, what was used earlier. So what we are doing here is now, let's say you have these two potential and you are kind of stuck here, right? And now you add a repulsive bias potential where you are right now. So now effectively, let's say now your system will go somewhere here and you keep on adding this bias potential and you essentially fill up this whole minima, okay? And then the system will flow back to the next available minima, and you keep on adding this repulsive bias. So essentially, you are not allowing your system to get comfortable in what, you're not allowing it to get stuck in any of the local minima. Wherever it is getting stuck, you are lifting the well so that it just goes somewhere else, right? So this is pictorial representation. After you add 10 bias potential, this is like this. After 20, it goes over here. After 40, it's going up. After 160, it goes here. And after 320, you have filled the whole potential, energy landscape completely. So how do you get back your original potential? So essentially, in the end, if the effective potential is constant, if you take the negative of whatever you have added so far, that will return what was the underlying energy landscape. So essentially, our goal is to adaptively add our bias such that at the end, I have a constant or uniform sampling of throughout my the coordinate space. So if my effective distribution is constant, whatever bias has been added will be the negative of the underlying energy landscape. So this is one of the most popular techniques that has been developed, and people are using this to understand complex energy landscape. And the beauty, one strong point of this method is you don't need to know a priori where are the other available minima. The system will automatically learn to explore the nearby minima. For example, when you push it out from here, it will automatically spill over to the next available minima. And again, after you fill it up, it will spill over to the next available minima, and it will continue. So you are essentially discovering the local metastable conformational states in this process, okay? Now, but in both of these classes of these methods, there is this problem that you need to know a priori what is your reaction coordinate. So if you have to bias your system, you need to know the functional form of that bias, and it has to be a function of some reaction coordinate that you hope will essentially describe the differences between all these metastable states. But you may not know the reaction coordinate a priori. So the question is, okay, so this is again just an animation of that, how this metadynamics works. It's flowing to the next minima and so on. So the question is that if you don't know what you are looking for and where to look for it, so then what is your reaction coordinate? So that's one of the challenges in this enhanced sampling methods, that's development of these methods, that how do you find out your reaction coordinate a priori? So to circumvent this problem, there is one final class of method that I'll mention, which I have used for this prion protein problem, is called replica exchange molecular dynamics, where essentially what you do is you simulate your system in multiple temperatures in parallel. So essentially, if you have this kind of an energy landscape, let's say, for example, you are stuck in this local minimum, and you are running your simulation at different temperatures in parallel, and at higher temperature, the system can cross over from this side to this side. And as it is coming down again in the temperature space, it can come down to another different minima. So this is kind of a schematic representation that this is your temperature space, and there are all these replica that is running in parallel, and you're exchanging your configuration between different replica with a certain probability. Like it's a like a Metropolis criterion. There is a if you have heard about Metropolis Monte Carlo. So essentially, you find out what is the probability, transition probability in going from this state A to state B, where you have this energy EI in state TI and energy EJ in state TJ to vice versa. So essentially, you are exchanging one configuration from one temperature to another temperature, and you can figure out what will be the transition probability associated with this process. So essentially, you keep on exchanging configurations between different replica, and your essentially system basically learns to traverse this energy landscape, and you can get the correct sampling at each temperature. Okay, so that's the whole idea that, so at each temperature, the trajectory will be discontinuous, but the proper Boltzmann distribution will be there at this temperature. Now here, we don't need to know any reaction coordinate a priori. You can post-process the trajectory. Essentially, you're just using temperature to accelerate your sampling, but you are not using any geometric parameter or reaction coordinate a priori, and you can find out later what will be the probability distribution with respect to different kinds of reaction coordinates later on. So this is that's the uniqueness of this method. Okay, so just to summarize, so there are different classes of techniques for this acceleration of sampling or the free energy calculation. So first of all, we can use simplified models where you avoid unnecessary details. We can use enhanced sampling methods where we apply certain bias or pathway. And newest addition to this is hardware acceleration where you can use things like GPUs to accelerate MD simulations. So in the first class, there are techniques like coarse graining where you describe a group of particles with maybe one bit where you can reduce degrees of freedom, multi-scale modeling, and there is also implicit solvent models where you can replace all the water molecules. You don't treat them explicitly, rather you treat them implicitly. So in this class of models, you try to reduce your number of degrees of freedom to speed up your evaluation of force, the computation time of the evaluation of force. And then I talked about these enhanced sampling methods, metadynamics, parallel tempering, et cetera. So this is an active area of research now to develop these techniques so that it makes it possible to access this complex energy landscape associated with biomolecules. So now let's look into this example. I'll basically the basic results I'll show you in context of this prion protein. So this prion protein has this kind of this nice folded structure, essentially consisting of three alpha helical domains, and there is a small beta sheet domain. And it has been linked to a range of neurodegenerative diseases. And the hypothesis is, the interesting part about this protein is, although the cellular prion form has a nice folded structure, it can misfold into a kind of an intermediate misfolded state called a scrapy form, which is also considered to be an oligomeric form, and which can induce misfolding into the cellular form. So essentially, it's a kind of a self-poisoning kind of effect, where the same protein, if it misfolds to a different structure, now that structure itself can infect itself. So it can induce misfolding into the healthy form. So that is something we are trying to understand here. So just some details that the cellular prion has predominantly alpha helical structure, 43%, and the scrapy form has been estimated to have about 50% beta sheet, but we don't have much idea about the structure of the scrapy form. It has not been isolated yet. And it's still unknown. So that's one of the challenges, that how do we find out the structure of that the toxic scrapy form? So, and the mechanism of this conversion. So just to show pictorially, this is the kind of the protein-only hypothesis of prion propagation, where the cellular form of prion, and it can basically interact with the misfolded scrapy form of prion and it can go into this scrapie form, and it can further nucleate into this kind of formation of this fibril, which will essentially, this is the hallmark of all neurodegenerative diseases, where the proteins will misfold and aggregate into this kind of fibrils, amyloid fibrils, which will deposit on the tissue to basically lead to neurodegenerative diseases. So the challenges here are, the structure of this intermediate toxic form is not known till date, and this mechanism of poisoning, how does the one conformational form of a protein induce misfolding into the another conformational form of that protein? That mechanism is also not understood. So these are the few of the challenges we are working on right now. So there are a couple of well-known models of this prion propagation. There are basically two models where it says that the first one is the template-directed refolding. So here, for example, this blue cube is the cellular, healthy cellular form, and here it is assumed that it cannot convert to the scrapie form directly because of high energy barrier. So there is a high energy barrier associated with this conversion. But it can form a heterodimer, and once it forms this heterodimer, then this the scrapie form induces the conformational change in the other healthy form, and then it further it propagates into this oligomeric state. And that there is another hypothesis that there is a dynamic equilibrium between the cellular form and the scrapie form, where it can basically, there is a seeded nucleation mechanism, that if there is a sufficient concentration of this scrapie form in the cell, that they can further nucleate and propagate into this, again, the oligomeric state. So essentially, the difference between these two models is the energy barrier between the interconversion between the cellular form and the scrapie form. So essentially, if we can find out the thermodynamics associated with the misfolding of, so first of all, there are two problems to look at. One is the free energy associated with the conformational change of the protein itself, and the thermodynamics of the interaction between the homodimers and heterodimers. So essentially, this whole the thermodynamic cycle should be shed some light into this model of aggregation. So we have used, again, I just put it here, so we have used this replica exchange molecular dynamics to look into it, and essentially, I'll just quickly summarize. So we have found this multitude of structures, so this is a structural ensemble from this REMD simulation, and we have found that there exist some low-lying metastable states where a region of this alpha helix, they convert into this beta sheet rich structure, which is from the experiments, we know that the scrapie form is supposed to have beta sheet rich structures. So we have some putative candidates which can be considered as the scrapie form structure. And then we essentially, we find this like a kind of a first order transition going from the folded state to the misfolded and unfolded state as a function of this temperature. But normally, the protein folding-unfolding equilibrium is considered to have a two-state picture, but we are going to show that actually this is not the case, at least in the case of prions. So I'll not basically, okay, so I'll just quickly go to the free energy surface. So the interesting fact that we found in the case of free energy landscape of prions is unlike regular globular proteins where they have one deep minima of a folded state, another unfolded state, here, as you can see, there are many low-lying metastable states very close to the healthy or native structure. Hence, it makes the protein rather prone to misfolding. So there are very close to the native state, there are some non-native metastable structure, low-lying metastable states, okay? And if we are very close to the melting temperature, as you can see, the free energy surface becomes really flat. So this is the end, this is the end state, which corresponds to the unfolded state, and this is the native state. And you can see that in this pathway, there are several intermediate clusters of conformational states. These are basically off pathway, and each of them can, each of them can be considered as intermediate misfolded states, and they can potentially contribute to the misfolding and aggregation pathways. So this, the scenario is really complicated here, and in future, we plan to essentially extract structures from here and look into the aggregation pathways associated with each of these conformational states. Now, so these are some snapshots from different structures. The interesting fact that we, essentially what we observed here, that what is the reason that this prion protein is so much prone to misfolding? What we find here, that as you go along this, the free energy landscape, so one popular choice of reaction coordinate is number of native contacts. Essentially, The native context is the contacts which are there in the native state crystal structure of the protein. So as the protein is going to the unfolding pathway, the number of native contacts is drastically going down, but the number of intramolecular hydrogen bonds is not changing at all. You know, hydrogen bonds is one of the key interactions which stabilizes the protein-protein interactions. So what we find is that there is a large number of non-native interactions or non-native hydrogen bonds which are stabilizing these local metastable states. So although the protein is essentially misfolding and unfolding, those states are actually stabilized by various multitude of local interactions and local non-native interactions. That's the reason why this prion is so much prone to misfolding. So these are, again, I'm basically highlighting the complexity of the free energy landscape. There are several multiple local intermediate metastable states, and we have computed this free energy landscape through various, as I was mentioning earlier, that you can compute free energy surface with any reaction coordinate once you have the overall trajectory from REMD simulation. And what we found, the coupling between various kinds of structural order parameter, for example, the hydrophobic solvent accessible surface area, and the fraction of residues forming beta sheet. So essentially what we find that in the misfolded states, the hydrophobic regions of the proteins, which don't like water, they are exposed and along the pathway. And essentially if you have these hydrophobic patches open, they will be more prone to, two proteins will be prone to come together and aggregate. So all these structural features will nicely come out of this, all of these free energy landscapes. So, and we have also looked into the reason behind this metastability, that all these alpha helical segments are not really stable by themselves. We have shown that through free energy calculations. And essentially what we have concluded in the end, that in this case, the protein, the inherent secondary structure of the protein of this say H2 and the other, there are three helical domains, and we find that this H2 and H3, two helical domains, they are not stable by themselves. So if you isolate them and take them separately in water, they will spontaneously misfold. And even if you, in the same protein, if you take out this H3 domain away from the rest of the protein, it spontaneously misfold. So somehow it is weakly held together. So this secondary structures of this protein is very weakly stabilized by the tertiary interactions, and whereas they are not stable by themselves. So that essentially here, the tertiary structure seems to stabilize the secondary structure. So it's a rather subtle balance of different kinds of interactions, which is first of all stabilizing the cellular form, and there are other interactions which are stabilizing the misfolded states of the prion protein, hence giving rise to this complex free energy landscape with multiple local minima. So that's the summary of it. And we have also started looking into the dimerization pathway, and we have found that there is heterogeneity and complexity in the dimerization of the formation of the homodimers and heterodimers. I'll not go into the details. So just to summarize, what we have learned so far from this free energy calculation is the cellular form is rather weakly stable with a shallow free energy surface with multiple low-lying misfolded states, and the misfolded beta sheet rich structures, so that we have identified, are more hydrophobic, and hence they are aggregation prone. And the helix 2 and helix 3 are inherently unstable if you take them in isolation. So, and they are kind of stabilized by the tertiary interactions in the protein. So those are the initiation sites of the misfolding. And this is like the Achilles heel of the prion protein, and this is the initiation point. And so in the dimer studies, we have found the evidence of cross beta sheet formation in the dimer, which is also kind of hallmark of propagation of this fibrillar structure. So the further challenges are that we want to look into this nucleation pathway towards fibril formation, and we are yet to understand what is the mechanism of the poisoning. So although we have found some of these misfolded states, now what we need to understand is how the proximity of these misfolded states can change the inherent free energy landscape of the healthy state. So what kind of interactions can induce this the self-poisoning? That is something we are now trying to understand from the free energy calculations. So this is the kind of overall pathway that thermodynamics and kinetics of the competing pathways that we should try to understand. So essentially the cellular form can go to this aggregation pathway via dimerization. It can misfold into this crepey form, and then that can go to the dimerization and the aggregation, or the cellular form can form a heterodimer with the crepey form, and it can go into this transition. So once we know the free energy and the kinetics associated with each of these pathways, we'll have a clear thermodynamic model that can describe the overall the energy landscape of prime folding and misfolding. That's where we are heading. So, and as you can realize, it's a very complex problem to look at from the free energy landscape, and we are going into that direction. So, and this is just one of the problems, and I just wanted to highlight, if any of you are interested, we have a major direction of activities in the context of biomolecular recognition and signaling, and where there are lots of this kind of interacting proteins. And we want to understand that how proteins are activated when external stimuli comes, a protein is activated, and how another protein recognizes that active state of that protein, and how basically proteins talk to each other. So this is one active area of research that I did not mention about, but if any of you have interest, I'll be happy to discuss. So I thank my students whose work I've presented here, and thanks to all of you.